Welcome to this particular lab class. This lab class will be teaching you a very important equipment or a facility, you can say, which is called biosafety hood. Now, what exactly a biosafety hood is and what kind of biosafety levels are there? You will see when the teaching assistant takes you to the lab class, but in general there are different kind of levels, level 1, level 2 and level 3. Now, what we will be looking in the lab is level 2, which is biosafety level 2, is also called in short form BSL2. BS stands for biosafety, L stands for level, and last number is 2. If you go for infectious diseases like HIV, AIDS, you need to go for level safety 3, L3, where level 2 can be used for with cancer cells, and also we can use let us say E. coli, certain strain of E. coli, we can go for level 2, and then level 1 is another class. So, we will be looking at the biosafety hood, how to use the biosafety hood. You should not put your anyway that the teaching assistant will tell you, but just to show you make it clear, there is a glass, and then you have to only put your hand inside the glass and work on that. Okay, you don't have to put your head inside the glass, then it's no point of having biosafety hood. All right, so that is to safely prevent the scientist or a lab member from exposing him or her with that particular bacteria or cells. So, you just have to insert your hand and work in the level 2. After you finish it, you need to clean it, wipe it correctly with ethanol. You have to also, generally it is advisable that you start the UV so that all the germs are killed before you start working on that. Some of the laboratories, they go for 12 to 24 hours of UV exposure. When UV is on, you need to be a little bit away from the biosafety hood, right? This is obvious, for obvious reasons. So, we will be discussing a lot of things like that in this particular lab class. We will be using this biosafety hood for a few experiments as well later on. So, learn about this hood, and then as usual, if you have any questions, feel free to ask. Till then, you take care. I will see you in the next class. Bye.
Hello everyone. Welcome to the course on sensors and actuators. Today, in this module, we will be discussing more about an equipment called the biosafety hood. So, there are different cabinets depending on the containment. Let us get into the details about what is a biosafety cabinet, what are the different cabinets which could be there, possibly there in a biological study workspace. So, there are two types of, when I am talking about a biosafety cabinet, this is totally different from a fume hood. So, when I say what a fume hood is, it is an environment mostly which looks like the biosafety cabinet. However, the sash, this is called the sash, which would also be available in fume hood. However, the environment why the fume hood is designed is, when you are working with chemicals, there could be volatile gases. For example, let us take xylene gas. It could release harmful gases. When we are working with such vapor or such chemicals which release vapors or fumes, and in such cases, we are supposed to use the fume hoods. So, this biological safety cabinet, the BSL cabinet, is different from the fume hood. So, that is point one which you need to take care even before you understand what is the choice of equipment before you work. Now that we have seen how the biosafety cabinet looks like, they are further classified into three classes, the BSL class 1, 2 and 3. So, this here is a class 2 biosafety cabinet. How are they classified? What is their purpose and why is it here in this laboratory? So, when we are talking about making MEMS based sensors, our focus here is to integrate biology with the micro engineered devices. So, our focus is more about making device such that it could be translated so that you take your device can enhance the diagnosis or repeatability of making multiple tests, such as we'll be talking about various cell and tissue cultures in order to understand breast cancer. There are multiple other devices, like you're studying about neonatal sepsis, antibiotic susceptibility, all of these. So we are talking about how we could make devices so that you could rapidly understand the diagnostic procedures or perform tests on them, so that you could understand how to go ahead with curing such diseases. So mostly we'll be working based on cell and tissue culture samples. So we'll be making microfluidic devices, and we'll be making MEMS-based devices, which are targeted towards making a diagnostic tool. So these devices would be integrated with such work environments which deal with cell and tissue cultures, biological blood samples. So anything related to biology, like I mentioned, the tissue samples, the cell culture, when you are having them in petri dish, or you might extract some sort of sample, so that could be harmful. It could have bacteria, it could have virus, and when that is just when you're using such samples and working in an open environment, they release the pathogens in them. The bacteria and virus could be harmful to the person who is working with them. In such scenarios, we talk about working in a safety cabinet like this, the biosafety cabinet. Like I mentioned just a few minutes ago, it is classified into class 1, 2 and 3. So it depends upon what is the containment, what is the safety levels. So when we're talking about class 1, the biosafety cabinet, so it does not protect the product. It protects the personnel and the environment where we are working. So when you are, say, assume this is a BSL 1, and when you are working in a workstation here, you have a device, and you have this device inside the biosafety cabinet. Once you have your device, the construction of the device is such that it has HEPA filters and pump, such that the air which flows in and the air that gushes out are always filtered, and it's such that it protects the environment, that is the lab environment where I'm working. There is no exhaust. The air which is being circulated inside this environment will not be released into the working condition. So it will be filtered and released through a proper exhaust chamber, and it provides protection to the personnel. So that was about class 1. And when we are talking about class 2, which this device is, the class 2 biosafety cabinet, it provides product, personnel and environmental protection. We will get into the details about the class 2 since we have it here. And then again, there is BSL class 3, which is for really sophisticated environments, like when you're working with hazardous pathogens and chemicals, when you are very stringent about containing the pathogen, the safety within the environment where you are working, in that case, you use the BSL class 3 safety hood. Now, what we see here is the BSL class 2. Getting into the details about how do you use this in a biological working condition. This, what I have here, the sliding glass, is called the sash. So the sash here is to protect the person. Here it protects me from any sort of aerosols, pathogens and other biological spills. Say I'm using a pipette and then I'm trying to use a liquid sample. You don't want that spill to infect you. And that is why we have the safety sash. And this sash level should be restricted to the safety line here. As you can see here, safety line with a warning symbol which says danger. So what, when you are using the sash, when you are using the safety cabinet while you work, make sure you keep the sliding sash on the safety line during the operation and do not impact the glass to avoid damage. So when you are working, ensure that you have the sash lifted only up to this line here. This has been designed to protect the person from any sort of contamination. So, when assume I would like to work here in the biosafety cabinet. So, when I'm working, I ensure that this does not exceed the limit and I limit my sash to the safety line and ensure you're seated in a proper comfortable chair and such that you could have your hands easily accessible to the devices where you're working. Another thing, do not put a lot of your equipments around this. For instance, when I have this device box here, this is actually restricting the air grill here. So make sure you do not block the air grills because, like I mentioned, the air filtration system here is such that HEPA filters, the air from this gap is sucked in because of the pumping system, and then the air that is blown from the HEPA filters, which are situated at the top of this device, will flush air and then they are sucked through these chambers from the bottom, refiltered, and part of it flows through your sample and the remaining goes as the exhaust. So the filtered air is being split in such a way that the filtered air which is free from all sort of particulate contamination would fall on your sample, and then the rest gets recirculated, pumped out of this chamber. So blocking these air grills here would not solve the purpose of you using the biosafety cabinet. Ensure these grills are free. So now that you've seen, even before I work, I follow a personal protective equipment like this. The PPE has to be followed. I'm having my hand gloves and the face mask and the hairnet. Again, even before I use the BSL hood, I need to ensure that I have my eye gears. So now, these are the eye gears which I'm supposed to use even before I start working using the biosafety cabinet. Now that I'm having the eye gears on, now always ensure that all the equipments or the things what you need while you work are available even before you start working using the BSL hood. Now here we have two options. Even before we start working, there is a UV light source option here. So yes, now as you can see, this is the UV light. The UV lamp is mainly provided. The switch here is to turn on the light source which is inside, just to sterilize the entire work environment when the device is kept idle. So once you're done, you could turn on the UV light and leave the cabinet so that the cabinet remains sterilized while it is not in operation. Again, when you have the UV light on, ensure you do not use the cabinet because UV light is hazardous. It could be harmful, and hence when we have the UV light source on, you can see the blue light inside is turned on in case you don't want to use the cabinet, and this is mainly used to sterilize the entire cabinet while it is not used. And like I mentioned, you are not supposed to put your hands or use the workstation while the light source is on. As a safety measure, in case my UV light is on and then I have my sash up, as you can see, it is programmed in such a way that the light turns off, because as we all know, it is dangerous and hazardous and not advisable to work while the light source is on. Now that we've seen how the UV light source can be turned on while your workstation, while you're not using the workstation and it is idle and you want to sterilize it after your work is done, turn on the UV light for around 15 minutes and leave it. Now, assume I want to use my workstation. So, there is a light source here with white light, and now my workstation is illuminated with white light and I can use the workstation. And while I use, like I mentioned, I sit in a position such that I get my sliding sash up to the safety line, and then I have all my things ready to perform my experiments. And this is mainly used when I said like the cell or tissue culture, the biological sample, all of this could be a contamination, could be hazardous to the personnel who is working with them. And hence you have such cabinet with a contained environment such that you have your devices here, you use the pipette, use the devices and perform your experiments within the containment here. Now assume I've finished using the workstation for my purpose. So you could always clean it up with ethanol, clean the workstation once you are done, and then what you need to do is you have a fan option here which can be used to properly recirculate air. So there are a few operation guide which are mentioned even before you use the safety cabinet. Though it is used to protect, there are a number of rules which have to be followed even before you start using the equipment for a proper efficiency or for in order to serve the purpose for which this equipment is being designed. So when you are having, make sure you have the, even before you start the fan, you can keep the fan running for 15 minutes even before you use the safety cabinet. Once you have finished using, you can turn on the UV light and leave the cabinet for sterilization. And when you come back, you can use the fan so that it is all, you could clean up the environment, and if there is any sort of contamination, that would be pumped through the circulation system and the HEPA filters which are inside, and there is clean air. And then minimize the activity around the cabinet. So when I'm here, ensure there are no multiple, there are two or three people around your workstation. You do not want any sort of disturbance. They could even increase the particulate contamination around you. So when you're using the safety cabinet, again, you need to make sure you minimize any sort of other activity, finish your work, and then have your workstation cleaned and then move out of the safety cabinet. And the UV light can only be on when the fan is stopped and the sliding sash is closed. Like I mentioned, the UV light could be hazardous, and hence ensure you work accordingly following all the operation guide which is here. So this was a brief introduction about how a biosafety cabinet can be used when you are working with pathogens which could be a potential hazard to the personnel or the environment in the laboratory. So this was about the biosafety cabinet. That's it for today. Let's see in future what are the other devices which can be used and integrated, and how they can be used to solve our purpose in lab. Thank you.